Cyberpunk stories often tend to take place either in the distant future or a world similar to our own, but not quite there yet. However, one might argue that it is possible to have a typical cyberpunk story, with all its technological and philosophical themes, that takes place right here, right now. This is where the American drama series Mr. Robot finds its roots. Mr. Robot was created in 2015 by Egyptian-American writer and director Sam Esmail. Set in present-day New York, the show stars Rami Malek as Elliot Alderson, a young man who works at a cybersecurity company, but who is also a very skilled hacker in his private life. The story focuses on Elliot's journey as he comes into contact with the infamous hacker group F Society and seeks to bring down the corporation known as E Corp, dubbed Evil Corp throughout the show. The first season depicts how the hack of Evil Corp comes to pass, and the subsequent seasons deal with the consequences of that hack. Another key character, whom Elliot meets in the first season in F Society, is the mysterious Mr. Robot, played by Christian Slater. Mr. Robot becomes both Elliot's mentor and tormentor as they battle with the dangers of hacking a powerful company and Elliot's deteriorating mental health. The show explores the hacker subculture with its light and dark sides, featuring groups that do not always apply their hacker skills for the most honorable reasons. Alongside, the show also addresses themes of personal relationships, capitalism, mental illness, violence and manipulation, and our perception of the world. Knowing cyberpunk stories are usually from literature or big blockbuster cinema, creator Sam Esmail, frustrated with the depictions of hackers in fiction, decided that he finally wanted to bring cyberpunk to TV. Nevertheless, if one were to take a brief look at the general presentation style of Mr. Robot, one might be tempted to say that it doesn't seem like a classic cyberpunk story. But what makes Mr. Robot so fascinating is the fact that it chooses its setting not in an apocalyptic dystopia, but our early 21st century society. This is where Sam Esmail creates and demonstrates a story that is not so much unlike the ones we see in Blade Runner or Neuromancer, because despite lacking the look and setting typical of cyberpunk, Mr. Robot combines many of the themes and issues integral to the genre by depicting them in its characters and their environment, essentially making Mr. Robot a contemporary reinvention of the cyberpunk genre. Even though cyberpunk can be a bit tricky to define as a genre, there are certain elements essential to it that most people would agree on. A society full of advanced technology, often relating to the internet, inhabited by morally ambiguous characters who constantly question the political and socio-economic structures of the system they live in. This seems to be a general description of a cyberpunk world, and if one takes a closer look, it's a world we can find accurately depicted in Mr. Robot. The most obvious classic cyberpunk element is the exploration of cyberspace, since the hacking subculture is essential to the show given the fact that Elliot is a skilled hacker himself. Elliot hacks everyone, including people he knows and likes, because to him this is the only way he can connect with people. Stash Receiver points out what lies at the heart of cyberspace is information, which everyone can access, manipulate, and contribute to. This understanding of cyberspace is a crucial part of many storylines of the show. Elliot gathers information because that is how he can understand the people and the society around him. The hacker groups, which are depicted in the show, F Society and the Dark Army, seek out and use particular bits of information they can access through cyberspace in order to manipulate and bring down not only individual people, but entire companies and their economic status in a capitalist system. Within those actions of the hacker groups, we can also see how our technology has come to interlink with many areas of our daily lives. The entire idea behind the company Evil Corp is that things such as money, personal data, and communication have become fully digitalized and have thus become accessible to such big corporations, which are then able to hold such things as financial debts against people. Even the concept of virtual reality comes into play here, as the character of Mr. Robot points out in the first episode.
Money hasn't been real since we got off the gold standard. It's become virtual software, the operating system of our world. And Elliot, we are on the verge of taking down this virtual reality.
The punk element of cyberpunk pertains to socioeconomic structures that are explored in their respective stories. Punk usually refers to a certain set of attributes. To be punk is to question authority and to actively subvert any of that authority you don't agree with. And that is the reason why many cyberpunk protagonists tend to be outsiders and critics of their own society. Now, this authority can take many forms, but the biggest one in Mr. Robot is probably that of capitalism and consumerism. It doesn't take much to notice that the show is very openly anti-capitalism. The entirety of the first season is concerned with a plan that is meant to take down Evil Corp, a company that holds 70% of the global consumer credit industry, and in hacking them, everyone's financial debt would be erased. Throughout the show, Elliot monologues to the audience how he despises society and the people in it because many either don't see or don't care about the consumerism that has enveloped their lives. Elliot openly discredits companies such as Facebook and Apple, and throughout the series, the viewers are constantly made aware of the lies and manipulations big conglomerates and politicians use in order to keep people sedated. Interestingly enough, Mr. Robot seemingly balances on the line between subgenres. Elements of cyberpunk are easy enough to find. However, another genre can also be found in the world of this show, namely post-cyberpunk. Lawrence Person very thoroughly went into the characteristics of post-cyberpunk, pointing out that while it is similar to classic cyberpunk in its general world-building, post-cyberpunk features different characters, settings, and, most importantly, makes fundamentally different assumptions about the future. Now, Elliot's character will be explored in more detail later, but for now, he is this perfect example for the transition between cyberpunk and post-cyberpunk. Elliot is very much the isolated and marginalized loner protagonist typical of cyberpunk, but at the same time, he also holds the more ordinary aspects that can be found in post-cyberpunk characters, such as having a job, general life responsibilities and obligations, and having to deal with relationships and family issues. Even though Elliot seeks to escape the society he so despises, he and the rest of the characters are very much part of it, which connects the show's perspective to the post-cyberpunk viewpoint that is about being inside the world looking around and not being an outsider looking in. How society itself and its faults are explored in both subgenres is also slightly different. Lawrence Person explains that cyberpunk characters frequently seek to topple or exploit corrupt social orders. Post-cyberpunk characters tend to seek ways to live in or even strengthen an existing social order or help construct a better one. In Mr. Robot, you find both of these elements coming into play as the show unfolds. In the beginning, Elliot and F-Society purely seek to call out and eventually destroy Evil Corp. However, the show also depicts some characters living and adapting in this world of capitalism, with one character, Angela, even working for Evil Corp. As the series goes on, the consequences of the Evil Corp hack become clear to Elliot, and he slowly realizes that he doesn't want to take this fight any further because it goes down many alarming ways he does not agree with morally. So instead, in later episodes, he decides to reset the hack and work against other hacker groups, thus choosing to help create a better social order instead of completely destroying it. Now, transitioning from the show's complex hacking, technology in general is also perceived differently in those two subgenres. Lawrence Person points out that in cyberpunk, technology facilitates alienation from society, and post-cyberpunk, technology is society. As explained earlier, the cyberspace the characters of the show move in is very much one that is integral to not only Elliot personally, but also our entire society. Elliot's whole life defines itself over his relationship with technology, and without said technology, his life and also society wouldn't function properly. Post-cyberpunk, according to Lawrence Person, explores a world of accelerating technological innovation and ever-increasing complexity in ways relevant to our everyday lives, which grounds the setting of Mr. Robot very much in our contemporary times, since nowadays it is almost impossible to imagine a life without our constant access to technology and the internet. While it is hard to describe Mr. Robot's main character, Elliot Alderson, in one sentence, Rachel Robinson Green manages to describe Elliot pretty well in general terms. Elliot is presented to us as a socially awkward, emotionally stunted, drug-addicted member of the counterculture. Now, counterculture is quite a big term. Nevertheless, it is quite clear that the specific identity of counterculture Elliot belongs to is that of the hacker class. His skills and actions as a hacker define a big part of Elliot's personality, because he admits that due to his social anxiety, he has a hard time connecting with people and thus decides to hack everyone, strangers and friends, in order to be able to understand them. Here, one can see a morally grey side one could apply to Elliot's character, because more often than not, he oversteps boundaries of personal nature. However, Elliot also continuously intends to apply his hacking for nothing he doesn't think of as morally justified. Elliot takes on many characteristics that are similar to a vigilante, or cyber-vigilante, someone who tries to do good through sometimes immoral means. As the viewer, we come to realize that even though Elliot feels trapped in the society he lives in, he also wants to improve it. In the first episode, even before the viewer encounters the plans of F Society, Elliot himself tells us,
"Sometimes I dream of saving the world. Saving everyone from the invisible hand. One that brands us with an employee badge."
In joining F Society, he finds his calling to bring about the change he always wanted. Both him and all the hacktivists in the show are tired of living in a world controlled by capitalism, and thus decide to create a new world via the hacking of the existing system. This is very much in line with the hacker principles described in Mackenzie Walk's Hacker Manifesto, in which he describes all hackers as a new class whose purpose it is to not only question society, but create new layers of it for other people to live in. Hackers create the possibility of new things entering the world. Not always great things or even good things, but new things. They are hackers hacking the new out of the old. While we hackers create these new worlds, we do not possess them. That which we create is mortgaged to others and to the interests of others. We do not own what we produce, it owns us. Walk describes a system in which the hackers stand opposite the vectoralist class, a group of people that is synonymous with conglomerates and authoritative capitalism, and owns and controls the means of production of information on an industrial scale. In Mr. Robot, this position is taken on by Evil Corp, a company able to influence the economic political existence on smaller and greater scale. Evil Corp stands as the perfect example for the accumulation and eventual abuse the vectoralist class practices in regards to the gathering and distribution of information. The fictional conglomerate holds society in its grasp. Its downfall can cause something akin to anarchy, as seen in Season 2, showing in how many ways it has made its way into every person's life. Everyone has become dependent on Evil Corp. Walk explains that this commodification of information means the enslavement of the world to the interests of those whose margins depend on information scarcity. Elliot constantly complains about the extreme levels of commercialism that have mingled with people's personal life. Very often we can hear Elliot point out the sedation the population willingly accepts by indulging the offers made by companies such as Evil Corp. Similar to what Walk describes as a mounting desire for information that meets the apparent lack of meaning and purpose in life, people, including Elliot, seek ways to stay active and purposeful in their lives. In the end, it all comes down to the hacker who has to challenge the system, the vectoralist class, in order to create something new that is free of corrupt misuse. The very hacking or creation of inherently new things is already meant to stand as an act of rebellion. The hacker class makes up new kinds of relation with new properties, which question the property form itself. Just as Elliot comes to realize in later episodes, it takes the actions of the hacker class, but also the understanding and consequences of their actions, in order to be able to create a new, better system. In resetting the hack of Evil Corp, in showing us that activists too, like the Dark Army, can become a corrupt form of authority, Mr. Robot tries to show the audience that one has to find a middle ground to have an improved society, one that seeks to permeate existing states with a new state of existence. It spreads the seeds of an alternative practice of everyday life. Now, being part of a counterculture movement already sets Elliot apart from normal mainstream society, but it's also his entire personality and perception of the world that pushes him farther and farther away from the world as the series goes on. His very appearance already intends to shelter him from the outside world. Elliot can always be seen wearing the same black clothes, and most of the time when he's outside, he wears his hood up in order to separate himself from the people around him. In the very first scene of the show, Elliot himself tells us that he does not consider himself a normal member of society.
"I understand what it's like to be different. I'm very different, too."
Elliot's anxiety and crippling depression separate him not only from society, but also from the few people he cares about. He's riddled by a deep feeling of isolation and fear of loneliness. They fuel his mania and constant sense of oncoming paranoia, both of which he's often unable to control. As the series unfolds, Elliot's mental state deteriorates to a point where his hallucinations turn into full-blown characteristics of dissociative identity disorder and schizophrenia. In trying to battle the pain, Elliot turns to drugs. He takes controlled dosages of morphine, knowing that to him this is a form of self-harm he uses as a tool of escapism. Entire side storylines in the show revolve around Elliot's drug habits and what calculations and means he goes to in order to sustain his addiction, making it clear how essential that desire to be sedated also sits within Elliot. Sam Esmail is quite open about the fact that he takes inspiration and direct artistic expression from other works, having said, "I rip off every movie and TV show I've ever seen in my life." So it comes as no surprise that many of the cinematic inspirations and homages we find throughout Mr. Robot more often than not either fall directly into the genre of cyberpunk or a genre closely linked to it, mainly noir or neo-noir. Let's take a look at three of the biggest influences on the show. The Matrix stands as one of the pillars of the cyberpunk genre, so naturally one can find nods to the movie trilogy in Mr. Robot. The first and most obvious parallel is that Neo and Elliot share their secret hacker identity. Beyond that, Mr. Robot also plays with our perception of reality. In fact, the whole story that unfolds after season 1, according to Sam Esmail, is meant to mirror this reveal and exploration of the Matrix. At the end of season 1, Elliot has come to realize that he is Mr. Robot, and thus the following episodes have to deal with Elliot now knowing the truth and having to live in the true reality. Just like Neo, Elliot finds himself in a stale world he doesn't find fulfilling, and it takes an enigmatic father figure to get the protagonist on his chosen path as they offer him the possibility of truth. There is an entire scene in the first episode of Mr. Robot that mirrors Neo's conversation with Morpheus as he is offered the pills, but instead it is Mr. Robot talking to Elliot about joining a society. Both Elliot and Neo are portrayed as the one who is able to bring about the change so that everyone can break out from the world of pretend. One of the biggest inspirations, according to Sam Esmail, for the show is the 1999 movie Fight Club. Also in this case, Elliot clearly takes off the movie's unnamed protagonist, played by Edward Norton. Just like him, Elliot suffers from dissociative identity disorder, which manifests in a much more dominant and active version of himself. The fourth wall breaking also comes into play here, with both Elliot and Edward Norton talking to the camera, and thus becoming an unreliable narrator who's not always showing us everything as it truly unfolds. Even the terroristic acts in both stories are similar. Whereas the group in Fight Club could be described as analog terrorism, F Society and the Dark Army in Mr. Robot could be described as cyber terrorism, but they still seek to destroy the same faults in society. And lastly, let us take a closer look at another movie classic, namely 1976's Taxi Driver by Martin Scorsese. The movie's protagonist, Travis, is a war veteran who, like Elliot, feels a deep-seated sense of loneliness and is alienated from the society he lives in.
Loneliness has followed me my whole life, everywhere. Bars and cars, sidewalks, stores, everywhere. There's no escape. And God's a lonely man.
I hate when I can't hold in my loneliness. This crying's been happening too often every other week now. What do normal people do when they get this sad? They reach out to friends or family, I think. That's not an option.
Just as in Mr. Robot, Taxi Driver is full of the main character's narration in the form of voiceover, which constantly monologues to the viewer about Travis's perception and criticism of the world. Both Elliot and Travis despise their respective societies, but still have to live in them. Yet both of them also seek to break out by various vigilante acts of socio and political actions in Travis's case and cyber-terroristic ones in Elliot, that become more and more drastic and violent as the story continues. All of those inspirations are very good examples for the huge influence the genre of noir, especially neo-noir, has on cyberpunk. Noir addresses themes of existential nature that we often find in cyberpunk works. For example, how is an individual to live a life of integrity in a world devoid of truth, justice, and absolute meaning? Neo-noir works often apply a certain visual style that is meant to create an uncomfortable setting that encapsulates feelings of danger, moral ambiguity, and alienation. For example, in Mr. Robot, we very often find the characters framed not only alone, but also on the very edge of a shot, creating a feeling of isolation as we watch them on screen. It's the same with the depiction of criticism against society. A big element of classic and neo-noir hinges on pointing out the threat by a world without meaning and the falls of capitalism, commercialism, and corrupt leadership. The earlier mentioned voiceover is a classic and useful device used in many noir works in order to communicate the main character's perception of the world to the audience. In Mr. Robot, we can also see sensitivity towards certain parts of society in the way the show depicts different places. The offices in the show are meant to convey wealth and status, and are shot in harsh blue-grey tones, leaving you feeling quite cold. whereas Elliot's flat is depicted in warmer colors and shown to be more cluttered and lived in, which gives the audience more of a feeling of familiarity and comfortableness. As mentioned above, Elliot Alderson stands in line with several protagonists that are not unfamiliar to the cyberpunk genre, Neo being the most obvious candidate. If we take a look at even more classic and even older characters of cyberpunk works, we can see that Elliot exhibits many habits similar to them too. William Gibson's Neuromancer is one of the original works credited with popularizing the cyberpunk genre, so it might not be such a big surprise that its main character, Chase, does seem quite similar to Elliot. Both of them are very skilled hackers, and the more interesting connection, they share a rather alarming drug addiction. There seems to be something to the idea of the damaged and slightly immoral main character in cyberpunk stories. In a way, Elliot is also similar to the detective protagonists we encounter in Blade Runner and Altered Carbon, men who have a strong belief and learn to question their respective societies. Elliot, just like them, in an inspector-like fashion, has to unveil a mystery and eventually stumbles across something that is bigger than he thought. A recurring topic in cyberpunk is also the question of identity and how we perceive not only ourselves, but the world around us. In more dystopic stories such as Blade Runner and Neuromancer, what makes us question our humanity are the cybernetic augmentations people give themselves, and sometimes they do not even know if they are human at all, see the androids in Blade Runner. Mr. Robot takes a similar identity crisis approach, however, it does so by exploring Elliot's mental health. From the beginning, Elliot cannot be sure if things around him are actually happening or if his mania is toying with him. After he discovers that he has dissociative identity disorder, Elliot finds himself in a constant state of questioning himself as he tries to figure out whether Mr. Robot is his own individual person, or if he might not simply be another part of Elliot's personality. Elliot's mental illness and status as an unreliable narrator is also what acts as a medium for questioning the world around us. Elliot, and thus the viewer, can never be sure if Elliot perceives everything as it truly unfolds. Similar to the construct of the Matrix, the society as depicted in Mr. Robot also implies that the world we live in is not real, and that we too, like Elliot, believe in illusions that imprison us. Elliot's very perception of society itself doubts everything, since we can never be sure if politicians or big conglomerates are lying to us. Just as in many classic cyberpunk stories, Mr. Robot makes the audience think twice about the world they live in, and whether or not we should simply take everything that is presented to us at face value.
Hello guys, John here. Thanks again for watching another one of my video essays. I tried using clips this time. I hope I won't get copy-striked or anything. But anyway, thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't done it already. And I hope I see you guys in the next video. Bye.